joined with four people that have, in some way or another, an affinity, an interest, a responsibility, passion for the topic that we're discussing about today. I'm joined by David Stewart, who's Assistant Deputy Minister of the Executive Government of Northwest Territories. Dr. David Ponton, who's an ER physician at Stanton Territorial Hospital. Amanda Mallon, counselor, chair of the Yellowknife Homeless Committee and co-chair, and chair of our Social Issues Committee. A active educator in the community and a proponent of making things sound so that you can understand them rather than making them complicated. And Wendy, Bisaro, MLA for Frame Lake, former city councillor and someone who is a very active spokesman for these types of issues, and a national award winner that you'll hear about within the next couple of weeks, or hear more about. So if we could start with Amanda.
Oh, thank you. Great. I'm really pleased to be here as co-chair of the Yellowknife Homelessness Coalition. I just joined the coalition in the fall of this year, and it's been a real honor and a voyage of discovery for me too. I just want to give you a little bit of background on the Homelessness Coalition. As been mentioned earlier, it was established in the year 2000, and it currently consists of approximately 30 NGO and representatives of levels of the government. A large number of you are out here. The vision of the Homelessness Coalition is that Yellowknife is a community where nobody is homeless or marginalized. Past achievements of the Yellowknife Homelessness Coalition. They've increased transitional housing for men with the Bailey House. They're increasing transitional housing for women and women with children through purchasing a number of small units. They've held a public forum on homelessness. They developed the 08-09 homelessness report card. They implemented a system called Homeless Individuals Families Informational System, HIFAS. And Yellowknife Homelessness Coalition was the first coalition in Canada to generate this report. And this report was used by the Yellowknife shelters to collect data. The goal of the Homelessness Coalition is that we work together to create betterment for the community. And we are very, very much, we were presented this report by Nick and Arlene on Tuesday. And we then had a Homelessness Coalition meeting after that. And the coalition itself is very, very supportive of the five recommendations. We strongly urge all levels of government to follow through with those recommendations. I just also wanted to point out, as has been mentioned by one of our earlier questioners and our mayor, that there have been a number of reports and studies that have been done over the last few years, and I brought them. There's No Place for Poverty, and the recommendations in here establish a process that involves everybody. Priority housing, priority flexibility and programs to allow people to get out of debt, priority Quebec model for accessible and affordable child care. We also have, as Lois Little mentioned, the report that's available on the City of Yellowknife website, which is called Championing Wellbeing in Yellowknife. 16 recommendations out of that, and no surprise, one of the recommendations that fits in so closely with the report on homelessness: champion the establishment and actively participate in a Yellowknife Interagency Social Council. Encourage and facilitate information sharing among the social agencies. So all of these recommendations, and I also have another report here that was done on the elder abuse. There's a lot of research, and it's all telling us the same thing. We need to get together. We need to work together to get these things done, because there's so many different groups across. I mean, Arlene, I think you mentioned you were involved in 33 committees, and I know that each one of those committees is looking to the betterment of our residents. Some of the things that I just wanted to point out is we're looking, the Homelessness Coalition is got three priorities. One of the things, we're working with the Betty Transitional Home, we're working to create a communications plan, and we're also working to strengthen the agencies that belong to the coalition. We look at a lot of, there are models around Canada that we can look at, and I just wanted to point out that one of the things that we are going to be doing in the Homelessness Coalition also is putting out some information about the successes we do. We really do urge particularly every level of government to follow that second recommendation, which is to involve the Homelessness Coalition in everything. We are representative of the community. And I just wanted to point out one of the things that that the City of Calgary has done, and it's really, we're looking at where things are now, but I also think that we need to look at where things can be. And just in the last few months, the City of Calgary, which has a homelessness coalition, and they have just closed 131 beds, the Salvation Army, because they don't need them anymore. Because those beds are empty, because they have moved those people from beds into apartments and housing units. In the last few years, they've moved 2,300 people from shelters into apartments using the Housing First model. So there's lots of good examples out there, and that's what we strive for. So looking at the recommendations from this study, we urge, as I said once again, please follow the recommendations. We would like to cooperate with any further research. If there's anything else from the other members of the Homelessness Coalition that I've missed, no, thank you. That's it from us for now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dr. Ponton.
Thanks, Gord. First of all, I'd like to extend my thanks to Nick and to Arlene and all of the hard work that's gone into this report. And I'd also like to say thank you for inviting me to speak here today. I spoke at a couple of forums like this, and I know I'm looking at a lot of similar faces. You know, we seem to have the same crew to a lot of discussions like this, and I certainly appreciate everybody coming by today. So my name is Dr. Ponton, David Ponton. I'm an emergency room physician at Stanton Territorial Hospital. I'm also director, the medical director of North Slave Correctional. So I spent a lot of my time dealing with the issues of poverty and homelessness, both in acute and in a chronic setting, and spent a lot of my time thinking about these issues. So I'm not particularly an expert on homelessness per se, but I certainly spent a lot of my time dealing with homelessness issues. And what I'm going to do in this few minutes that I've been granted here today is focus specifically on what I see as the health issues related to homelessness in our society. And homelessness has been identified time and time and time again as a major determinant of health within the population, within the health of a population. So in many ways, if you want to make a population healthier, you don't just throw money at the healthcare system, you also have to deal with issues of poverty and issues of homelessness if you want to make a population healthier. And I'm not just talking about the homeless population itself, but I'm talking about population in general. So I'm going to talk also a little bit about why that might be here in a few minutes. So when I think about homelessness, like all emergency physicians, I sort of think about some of the acute issues associated with homelessness and some of its dangers. And I also talk about some of the chronic risks of homelessness to health in general. So what I'm going to talk about a little bit to start with is this issue of homelessness in the acute setting and some of the challenges we have there. One of the things that makes me very, very concerned from the acute issue is what Nick brought up in his talk today, that in our emergency shelters, we have 50 some odd men accessing our emergency shelters every night, sleeping about a foot apart from one another. And in Nick's report, he's also talked about how there have already been, in the last few years, two or three deaths in that shelter. And the issue is that a lot of those people that come in there are not just homeless, but they're intoxicated. And one of the issues as well is that intoxicated patients can also have other things going on. They can have infections going on. They can have head injury. They can have a whole bunch of things. And they're put into the same room with everybody else with one staff member. And that's an extraordinarily dangerous situation. There are multiple coroner's inquests going on across the north that have wrapped up in the Yukon, recently here, as well as in Iqaluit, dealing with precisely this issue. The fact that people who are intoxicated, who are often homeless, are being sent to non-medical facilities and then end up dying in those facilities or end up extremely brain injured from an unrecognized head injury. So one of the things we need to think a little bit about is how we safely deal with the overnight homeless and intoxicated population of this city in a safe way. The other sort of acute issue that I'd like to at least put out there as an observation is that one of the important overnight shelters for the homeless in this city is the emergency department. So we shelter, especially through the winter time, in our waiting room and as well as in the emergency department, up to 5 people a night, okay? And usually these patients are often intoxicated or have other health issues, but we're an important resource for overnight shelter, and the emergency department is frequently used that way. So I guess just kind of raising people's awareness to that. So the other thing I just want to briefly talk about is the chronic issues associated with homelessness. So as I mentioned, homelessness is an extraordinarily important determinant of health of a society. And one of the reasons that is because of things like our TB outbreak here. When you have a homeless population, particularly a situation like we have here with our emergency shelters where people, again, are very close together, it's very easy for outbreaks to spread, especially when they're airborne outbreaks, one person to another. So the outbreak that we had here in 2008 and the 14 people that were infected then were a direct result of close contact in that type of setting. The other important thing that to recognize about that outbreak is, guess what? It spreads, okay? It spreads beyond the confines of that homeless population. So we had children infected from that TB outbreak. The Delaunay outbreak that happened approximately a year later can be directly linked. We'll have to talk to the chief, but it's possible that the Delaunay outbreak was directly linked to the Yellowknife outbreak. So we ignore the health needs of the homeless at our peril, okay? Because it starts to spread into the rest of the community. It's costly to our medical system, and it gets a lot of other people very sick. The other issue is that our highly addicted homeless population is a sitting duck right now for another outbreak that we know is coming. We're not seeing it yet, but we know is going to be here, and that's HIV. What we've seen, my training is in Vancouver, and I trained there in the 1990s, and so I was really on the ground in many ways when HIV exploded in the downtown east side there, and so I know firsthand what happens when HIV sweeps through a community. And that community on the downtown east side was homeless, predominantly Aboriginal, highly addicted to alcohol and crack cocaine. We had epidemics of syphilis and other things go through that community, and then suddenly HIV hit, and Vancouver had the highest incidence of HIV in the world for a period of time. So incidence is new diagnoses, essentially, of HIV. And it took everybody by surprise there, and was a wake-up call to everybody in Vancouver about the important ramifications of ignoring the health needs of your homeless population as a risk to the rest of society. So that population, when I came up here, was exactly the population that we see in our streets of Yellowknife today. They're no different. The only difference is that HIV hasn't come here in a big way yet. And my concern is that, like then in Saskatchewan and other places, that it is going to come here. And I've said this before, and I'll say it again, that we're in a situation here where we have kindling. We just don't have a flame yet. And when the flame comes, it's going to be a big deal. And so we have this very, very important window of opportunity right now to try and deal with the situation before HIV hits. And HIV will be a big, big problem for the city. I'm going to take one last minute here, if I may, just to very briefly introduce a very, very important concept that Nick had mentioned briefly. It's a concept of harm reduction. And harm reduction is the idea, as Nick was pointing out, that the expectation that our highly addicted members of society that are often part of a homeless population are suddenly going to stop drinking or doing cocaine or other things is pretty small, and there's a lot of barriers to that. So we have had to adopt through time the idea that it's better to take people where they're at, wherever they are in their addiction, and to sort of implement the idea of incremental change, of trying to reduce harms. So if someone, for example, is using intravenous cocaine, well, we try to say, well, why don't you try intravenous heroin instead? You're taking it less often, and the chances of transmission of HIV might be less if you take it more often. If you're using needles, use clean needles, you know? If you're using heroin IV, maybe think about using methadone. And there's a gradual pulling away of very dangerous types of drug use. And it's that kind of idea where you are just using gradual incremental change to try and reduce risk. One of the things in Yellowknife is sort of this curious observation we've made is that this group of people that Nick identifies in his report of homeless living in tents around the city. One of the things we've observed is that people who have tents close to town do a lot of cocaine. People who live on the other side of Frame Lake in tents tend to be alcohol only. So one of the things we do in the emergency department is we suggest moving their tent to the other side of the lake. And that actually makes a difference. So that's an example of harm reduction strategies that we use. And it's a key part of dealing with health in this population. So I think I'll stop there and pass it over to my other colleagues. And thank you for your time.
Thank you, David. Wendy.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Gord. I want to say at the outset, I'm really pleased to be here. I'm also somewhat disappointed that Bob Brownlee could not also be here. Bob shares my passion, along with a couple of other members from the Legislative Assembly, for social issues, and I know this is an issue that's near and dear to his heart. However, he is in Wati this morning and was unable to make this. I also want to thank the various people that were involved in producing this report, particularly Nick, but I know that there were a lot of people in this room who were interviewed by him and provided, you know, background information for the report. So thank you very much. I think that from what I read of the report, I think it's an excellent report. And I think the thing that struck me the most in the report was, as Nick pointed out, the synthesis of all the information that's out there, all the things that are going on. That we don't necessarily know are there, and this puts that information all in one place. I should back up a bit. I should say I'm a member of the Legislative Assembly for the Frame Lake riding here in Yellowknife. I'm a regular member. I'm not part of cabinet, and also a member on the Standing Committee for Social Programs. And we try to deal with many issues such as this, and to keep the government to account and to try to change the course of the monster that is the bureaucracy and the elected members of the government, which is a really difficult thing to do. So that's kind of my focus for my comments. I think that this report is good fodder for us at this time, for one thing. I am getting really cynical towards the end of this term, because that pretty much responds to any suggestion for change at this point in time is, well, that'll be left for the 17th Assembly and for the members after the election in October. However, there's still an opportunity to make noise about this report. I would hope that somebody else will table this report in the August sitting, which middle of August. I would certainly like to table the report. It then gets a broader view, and it becomes an sort of an official document of the Assembly. So I will certainly be willing to do that. I'm really looking forward to the historical report. I think it's something which it doesn't sound like it's ever been done, and I agree with Arlene that if it can provide a good solid background for this is what promises were made and we need to go forward with that, and absolutely. I'm really disappointed in the federal government that they have backed off of providing funds for housing. You know, we can get money for capital expenditures, but they're backing off on the provision of operations and maintenance funding for all of our public housing. And I think it's 2032 when we're going to be down to basically zero and have to provide millions and millions of dollars for the upkeep of the current housing, public housing infrastructure that we have from the territorial government coffers. And it's huge, it's millions and millions. So I don't want to give you a number because I can't remember what it is. The thing I think that frustrates me the most with regards to housing and health issues and many of the issues that Dr. Ponton talked about and sort of everything that's referenced in this report as well is the lack of coordination within the government for many of these issues. They are all, you know, tied into each other. I was sitting here, and as an example, we have a program within the Department of Health and Social Services, which is a really good one, I think. I've heard nothing but good reviews for it. It's a healthy families program. And it starts with children at age zero or pre-birth and through birth and zero and up to 6 years or so, as much as possible. It's a new program, and it's working its way up and getting broader. But that's the kind of thing, in my mind, that we need to be doing. We need to be putting more money into that. That's a health program, but it crosses over into social services, and there's a few issues in terms of people not wanting to get involved because it's a social worker that's coming to them and they think their child's automatically going to be removed, but that's another story. But, you know, homelessness fits into that as well. If you've got somebody who doesn't have a home and has a new baby, you know, there needs to be a coordination between the Department of Health and Social Services and the NWT Housing Corporation so that all the problems for this family get dealt with at one time. And we're sort of starting to move in that direction, but I see from my perspective as a member that we are so piecemeal, and that was pointed out quite well in the report by Nick. But I also find that there's a huge unwillingness to make change, and it's going to take a long time. It's not something that we can change overnight, but we do have to get rid of the silos. We do have to force ministers and then bureaucracy at whatever level to think that this is not just my problem, this is a problem across the government. And I really like the recommendation to try and establish a secretariat. And there's been a couple of, I think it was mentioned by somebody, but suggestions for secretariats in a number of other areas. When I sort of heard about that, somebody saying we need to say another secretariat, it's like, it's not going to happen now. And again, my cynicism about this last several months comes forward. But I think it's something which absolutely should be discussed when the new assembly is elected. There's always a strategic planning session, kind of a visioning and strategic planning session with all members before, hopefully this time around it'll be before the ministers are selected. And at that point in time, that's when I think members should be talking about broadening the scopes of various departments or creating new departments. One of my pet peeves is that I think social services should not be in with the Department of Health. No offense, ladies, but I think it needs to be its own department. It's something we had years ago, but we have gone away from it, and I think we need to go back there. But I think we need to publicize through you guys that are here, but also I think just through general people. When we come to the election, I think this should be an election issue. Homelessness should be an election issue. Working together, coordinating across departments as a government should be an election issue. And after your MLA is elected, talk to them and say, what are you going to do at the strategic planning session relative to homelessness, relative to working across departments? What are you going to say for me at this strategic planning session? Because it's one thing to do it prior to the election, you don't know who your member is, but after the election you do know, and you have a period of maybe a week or so to get a hold of your member and bend their ear and tell them what you want them to do. I am really happy that the Housing Corporation is doing a shelter policy review, and I've heard the comments from a couple of people about their concerns about the input. I'm a little concerned myself. We had a meeting with Housing Corp to get an update a little while ago, and talk is cheap, I guess, is the best way to express it, and I don't necessarily believe that everything that the Housing Corp said is going to happen, but they certainly are intending to contact the providers and the users and so on. Time will tell whether or not we get that. Somebody mentioned housing continuum, and that's something which I have felt for quite some time where we are lacking. I didn't realize until I read the report how badly single individuals are in terms of public housing here. I knew it was a problem, but I didn't realize that basically the policies that we set out don't allow for single people to get housing. Again, I have discovered in the last 3.5 years that we have policies in one department that inhibit the operation of another department, and we have policies in another department that inhibit a third department, and there's no consideration across the board that this policy is creating a problem for somebody who's just lost their children and can't get back into housing. And so that's, I hope, what the shelter policy review will do, that it will look across departments to see what the policies are and what they can do to change them. It's a big job, but you know, even if the Housing Corporation itself clarifies and evens out their policies, that would be a big step forward. I totally support Lida's position on transition housing. I think it is an area where we are lacking. I've pushed it a bit in the assembly. I've met with the housing minister and tried to sort of say, doing this shelter policy review, what are you doing about transition housing and the fact that it's not provided as public housing, it's provided by social service providers. And I'm hopeful that that will be again part of the shelter policy review, but there needs to be a better continuum of housing from absolutely nothing, somebody who has nothing, to somebody who has everything. And we need to provide for everything in between, from A to Z. And we also have to, as has been pointed out, make sure that from a financial perspective, people aren't paying huge amounts of money on their rent in a monthly situation. Again, in talking to Lida, I never really realized, Lida, that it's actually 50% that some people are spending on their rent in Rock Hill. I knew it was high, but I didn't think it was 50%. I mean, that's just not tenable, you know? You get somebody who's off the street into Rock Hill, they now have a place, they're able to look after their family, but they're working a low-wage job, and then they're automatically behind the eight ball because, you know, 50% or more of their income is going to rent. So those kinds of policies are relatively simple to put into place. I know it requires a subsidy, but there's lots of money out there for subsidy. We have to move it around and put it where it's going to help people the most. Government may not like that, but Dave can comment afterwards. what else did I want to say? I think the only other thing that I want to really point out is that in the recommendations, two things I wanted to mention. First of all, prevention, I think, and I really agree with Dr. Ponton, he talks about harm reduction, but a focus, and Bob Bromley and Glenn Abernathy have been pushing this as well, but a focus from the three of us and also from the Social Programs Committee is prevention. And it's similar to harm reduction, but a little different. And the Healthy Families Program is, for instance, one that is a preventive program, and it teaches people how to deal with their children from, you know, from when they're born and onwards. If we keep people healthy, then we don't have the problems that we have to deal with our hospitals and clinics and so on. So, I think the prevention focus is, again, something which can be an election issue, and again, after your member is elected, it can become something that you talk to your member about prior to our strategic planning session and say, you know, this is something that's important. I want you to put a focus on this when you talk about strategic planning. Lastly, in terms of the recommendations, I think the recommendations in the report are excellent. I do see that the third one, which is to develop standards, that's not so difficult, but providing the sufficient funding is a problem. Automatically, when you suggest that a program needs more funding, government and bureaucracy tend to kind of, you know, withdraw and go into seizure mode. But it's not something which has, again, has to happen tomorrow. And I think if we develop standards, we set a goal, we can then find the money that's going to fund to the standards that we set. And it'll take a number of years. It may take 10 years, but we have to start. And if we don't start, we'll never get to the end point after 10 years. So thanks very much to everybody. And I really have appreciated the questions and the comments in the previous session. I really am I'm learning by listening to the panelists that are here, so I'm very, very happy to be asked to be on here, so thanks a lot.
Thank you, Wendy. And you created a deja vu moment there. In 99-2000, Arlene and I were the two non-government representatives on a six-department development project to see once the pipeline hits, what's going to happen to your community. And one of the silos fell on the other five and it disappeared. And I don't know if I ever mentioned to you, Arlene, that report was completed. And I have a copy if you ever want to see it. Now, to David Stewart.
So thanks. I'll try to keep my comments brief, but I don't know if my feelings should be heard after talking to Wendy, because, or hearing Wendy talk, because I'd be part of that monster that she refers to and probably the source of some of her cynicism, and maybe even be the cheap talker that she refers to as well. So we'll try to keep that down to a minimum. Just by way of introduction, I guess, I'm David Stewart. I'm the Assistant Deputy Minister in the Department of Executive, and one of my roles in the government is around strategic planning. So I spend a fair amount of time at what I call a 50,000 foot level, looking at all of the issues within the NWT and try to do it at a territorial level and look at everything from some of the environmental and land issues to the social issues and the economic development issues. And I think this paper is a really valuable piece of work. And but the first thing I'd absolutely want to do is to thank the Center for Northern Families and Carleton University, and more specifically Nick and Arlene, because as those that maybe know me, my background is actually in statistics, and I think the more evidence and the more informed debate there is, I think the better you end up with in terms of decision making. And so the research, I think, plays a very important role in that regard. In terms of the research paper itself, it certainly provides a very good overview of the issues around homelessness and the various program responses. And before talking maybe a little bit, I think, again, given my role in government, I sort of remiss if I didn't sort of put the context around some of the issues that are raised in the paper. We met with Nick and Arlene and certainly recognize that the paper is focused on homelessness in Yellowknife. As the GNWT, we always have to worry about a more of a territorial view and then put these issues in the context of the territory. And one of the challenges that Wendy is well aware of is for our political leadership is trying to set some priorities, and that is a real challenge. So it was mentioned, Wendy mentioned the housing continuum. So if we look at the housing continuum, it involves everything from homelessness, obviously, at one end, to transitional and supportive housing, to social housing, or what we call public housing here, to market housing, and all the way through home ownership. And when we look at it from the GNWT's perspective, and it's an interesting point that Wendy made about the balance between those various components. So what is the right mix between looking at supports and programs around homelessness versus, and I'll just move down the continuum, versus the amount of social housing we have versus how much support or the kinds of supports we provide for people that may want to get into home ownership? What's the right mix between all of those things? And how do we mix those between some of our market communities, including Yellowknife, versus some of the non-market communities, the smaller places where home ownership becomes quite a challenge? The range of supports is also something that I think is important in terms of context for the paper. And again, I understand there are other papers that will address some of these things, but just to mention them from a context perspective is there's about $3.5 million to $4 million a year spent in Yellowknife on public housing that the GNWT spends. So the paper provides a good overview of some of the funding and the funding responses for transitional and some of the emergency shelters, but it needs to be put in context. So Wendy mentioned the idea of, do you move resources around? And in this fiscal capacity that we've got, or this fiscal environment that we have in the NWT, is that something that we need to look at? Certainly much easier to find new things to do than to stop doing some things or to take programs away from some areas, and that's a challenge that our assembly faces almost on a daily basis. The other thing that I would just mention around the housing continuum is there's about $2.5 million provided through the GNWT to other sort of supported housing areas, so through things like Borealis Co-op, Inukshuk co-op that provides sort of low-cost housing options as well. And so the whole continuum needs to be looked at as you start to think about the program responses on a go-forward basis. I would also be, I guess, remiss if I didn't talk about the context of homelessness, and this is in no way to take away from the issue of homelessness in Yellowknife, because I think we all know, particularly the visible homelessness, is a huge issue in Yellowknife and one that's quite apparent. But we do have to put it in the context of housing issues across the territory. So, for example, if you look at the standard kind of definitions of housing problems are houses that have problems with affordability or the cost of housing, suitability, which is really related to crowding issues, and then adequacy, which is the quality of the housing or houses that need major repairs. Across the territory, the most recent data we have on that, a full 32% of houses in the Northwest Territories have one of those problems. So that's around 5,000 or so households that have a problem there that needs to be addressed. If you go to our non-market communities, it's 55% of households. So when you think of the context of those program responses and the pressures, and not to sound whiny, the pressures on the GNWT to support all of those problems, there are some enormous problems in the territory when it comes to shelter. We just recently completed a study that also looked at the underhoused, and this is fairly new data, but overall about 5% of households in Yellowknife, 11% in the regional centers of Inuwik, Smith, and Hay River, and 19% in our smaller communities are households where there are people sleeping in areas other than bedrooms. So again, from an underhoused perspective, we have to put that in the mix of the continuum as well. That those aren't necessarily people that are out on the streets or living in tents, which is obviously got a huge amount of issues with it. But the health concerns in terms of crowding and the concerns of the linkage of housing to education and to the ability of children to do well in school and just overall population health, that's a huge another challenge that I think the territory faces. And then you could go on, and you're well aware of many of the other issues in terms of the problems that and some of the challenges that face the Northwest Territories around the social realm. I was very pleased to hear Wendy mention around the federal government and the CMHC funding, because I do have the number. And the number is the decline of federal funding for social housing in the Northwest Territories will be $33 million. So if we are to keep the same level of social housing programs that we have today, the GNWT is going to need to come up with $33 million over the next, it's till 2038 is when it expires, but it's going to have to come up with $33 million just to meet the current situation. So either we can do less social housing, we could redirect it into other areas, or we need to fill the gap. And that's going to be a huge challenge when you look at the fiscal environment in terms of on a go-forward basis of how do we even maintain what we have rather than as opposed to increasing. Not that it can't be done, but when you talk about priority setting, it is going to require a major commitment from government, unless the federal government reverses its position, which with provinces and territories across the land have been trying to get them to do that since they announced they were getting out of social housing. So unless that gets reversed, that's something that the territorial government is going to need to face. And I think certainly the issues around that declining funding is something that I would say is very important. It was mentioned around the shelter policy review, and I think this paper's timing is really quite good. The shelter policy review, I'm one of the co-leads on the shelter policy review, so the chief talker would be me in this case. We absolutely are starting an engagement process where we've been doing a ton of background research on shelter issues, and the work that Arlene and Nick have done here I think are critically important to fit into that process. The shelter policy review is going to look at the entire continuum. So what I mentioned before, right from homelessness all the way through to home ownership, including social housing, transition housing, and the whole nine yards. And I think this work provides a good basis to start to look at the one area around homelessness and some of the transition, if you want to call it that end of the housing continuum. We absolutely will be meeting with the Homelessness Coalition and involving the people that are providing housing, the NGO community that are providing housing. This engagement that we're going to be doing with the public, there's various components to it, but we will be starting the end of next week where we're meeting with community and regional leadership in the Beaufort Delta. We'll be having a similar meeting with the leadership of communities in the south. We're going to have meetings with the Clicho government as a government-to-government type of arrangement. We're going to be engaging with residents and with client groups and communities across the territory. We will be having a workshop with the NGO community, both here in Yellowknife and hopefully bring in some that are from other communities, the Yellowknife or the Nubic Homelessness Shelter as well, that I think I'd like to make sure they're there as well. And it's really to gather up people's views and perspectives on the various components of the continuum. There are some enormous pressures there in terms of the what we already know about, and I mentioned the CMHC funding. There's huge demand for increased investment in public housing, that there's a need for more public housing. And when you look at the number of places that are out there, or households that are out there that are, have people sleeping in areas outside of bedrooms, it does show that there's a supply issue that's huge in our communities. There's also huge calls for increases around home ownership units, and more government should do around that. We've heard demands is probably a strong word, but suggestions in the House, the Legislative Assembly, and from others that the impact of the lack of housing has in our smaller communities on being able to attract teachers and nurses, and that the availability of those resources to help move forward as a territory. And then finally, I think we heard fairly loud and clear at the No Place for Poverty workshop and in talking with folks after around the working poor in some of our larger communities. The challenges of somebody that maybe has a job that they make 25, 30 grand in Yellowknife and are facing rents of you know, 1500 or so a month, and you start to see some very high percentage of income. So all of those things, as well as transitional housing and homelessness, all have to be put in the mix. And we're very, very keen, or at least I am, I know, to hear people's views of that balance. The government's fiscal situation is real. The main driver of our formula with Canada, which does provide most of the funding to run the territorial government, is population. If you look at the population of Northwest Territories today compared with back in 2004, there's about 300 extra people. So if you're experiencing zero population growth, you can expect that the revenues of government are essentially not growing a heck of a lot either. There's other factors that have an impact, but they're not growing a heck of a lot. So in terms of program solutions, we're either going to have to find ways of doing things better, we're going to have to find ways to do things without resources, or we're going to have to make some tough decisions of stopping doing certain things and starting to do others, and those are tough choices to make. There's also revenue options, obviously, and that's a much broader discussion as well. Finally, in terms of some of the other demands, and I think, you know, Wendy mentioned the cynicism of coming to the end of an assembly and the start of a new one, and I'll support that cynicism at this point. In that each assembly, when it comes in, it really is a fresh start to say, what are our priorities? What is it that we want to try to get done as an assembly? And I think that priority setting exercise, it's not perfect, but it is an important one in terms of trying to set that agenda over the next 4 years. But housing is just one of the things that are on that agenda. I just did a quick list of I think Wendy sometimes thinks, or some of the members maybe sometimes think we're not listening, but here are some things that are on the list that just came out in the last 3 months from the Legislative Assembly in terms of programming. Programming corrections facilities to deal with violent repeat offenders. Increased policing services in small communities. Infrastructure in small communities. The highway upgrades both around the yard and in between Hay River and Enterprise. The Tuck-Anubic Highway, the Mackenzie Valley Highway, health facilities including Stanton, standalone campus at Aurora College, development of the Northern University, increased support for apprenticeship training, expanded early childhood development, energy and environmental issues that need to get funded, healthy families program and expansion to that, expansion to the respite program, expansion of the midwifery program, increased supports for youth and suicide, seniors programming, and then some of the economic development initiatives and the need to support that. None of those are bad ideas, and certainly the recommendations that are presented in the report aren't bad ideas either. The reality is they all cost money, and I think that's where the priority exercise starts to kick in, is what is the list? What is those priorities that we feel most strongly about? And that's where our political leaders get paid the big bucks to try to set those priorities, and then it's up to this monster bureaucracy that I'm part of to actually try to go through. Now, the point I want to make sure is that there should be no confusion that I'm not saying is that the issues related to homelessness and the recommendations aren't on that list, because they absolutely are. The challenge is how do you do those things as well as address some of those other issues that we mentioned, and that's hardly an exhaustive list of, I think, everything that could be done. So finally, just to wrap up before I get on too long, again, want to thank Dr. Abel and Nick and Arlene. Making choices is a tough business, but if you don't have good evidence, it becomes even a tougher business. So thanks a lot.
I want to thank our sponsors, CERNOC is the research project, multi-year research project, representation from throughout the country. That's the group that Arlene approached a couple of years ago for this research to start. We want to thank the Center for Northern Families. Arlene has been an outstanding research partner. Carleton University, got to thank them. I do want to graduate someday. The Homeless Hub, they're the folks that help disseminate this. The Canadian Homelessness Research Network, they fund the Homeless Hub. That's your tax dollars at work. Also your tax dollars at work, Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council of Canada. They fund CERNOCA and the Canadian Homelessness Research Network. INAC provided funding for my trip in March. They have something called the Northern Scientific Training Program that provides enough funding for one short trip to the north. And that's what I used in March to go to Ray and to come here also to talk to people about their reactions to a draft. Thank you very much. That is our contact information. And I think Arlene wants to say a few words now.
Well, the only other sort of two things I wanted to say is to thank the people in the government and in the service provider sector that participated in the research and spoke to Nick Falvo and really gave the foundation for that piece of research. The other thing I wanted to encourage you to do is really look on the Canadian Canadian Homeless Research Network website, which is called the Homeless Hub. And the really interesting thing about that is it has real short scenarios of what research is available there. The other piece of research that the YWCA spearheaded around women and homelessness in the North is on that website. And they have stories from people who are homeless. So it's a really well-balanced kind of website and a real resource for anyone working in the field of poverty and homelessness. So I'd encourage you to go to that website and, you know, participate in that and download documents that you think might be important or valuable to.